Good morning, Star. How are you this morning?
Well, good morning, Michael, and I thank you so much for having me on your show.
I got your email, I guess it was Saturday, and it is a disturbing story, and I am, partially because I am on the radio, I am starting to get numerous accounts like this. So, you know, first of all, let me just say that I am so terribly sorry that you had to go through this, and I appreciate so much your willingness and courage to come and share this story instead of going along with the flow, as it were.
Well, I have to say the same for you, Michael. I greatly admire your bravery and your love for family and brotherhood and defending our rights and this land that we believe was free. I just can't thank you enough for all that you do also.
Giving men and women and children's sovereignty. We need to understand who we are as kings and queens. As the ones who inherited this planet and the rightful heirs to it.
About yourself, where do you live? You know, what claim to fame you may have?
Well, I'm a musician, and I play guitar and write songs, and I live mostly in Bakersfield. I've been entrusted to my family legacy there, my home my grandfather built in 1942, and my father's yacht, which I've had for 14 years, and I just traveled to Marin County, where I've kept it for the last 14 years, to release it to the new owner, as it's been kind of a hardship to travel from Central California to Northern California to take care of it and my grandparents' home also.
So, just so that our listeners know, if they want to kind of follow along, you have a MySpace page. They can go to myspace.com/road_school, S-K-U-U-L. Is that what that's supposed to be?
Yes, that's correct.
And Bakersfield, first of all, for those who don't know, Marin County is up there near San Francisco. So your dad's boat was in San Francisco Bay?
Yes, just north of San Francisco,
Okay. And so that is a long trip. What is that, 5 hours maybe?
Yeah, it's about 6 hours.
Well, it's very sad, but why don't you tell us what was going on? You drove 6 hours from Central California up to the San Francisco area into Marin County, and you were selling your dad's boat. You've been in possession of the boat for 14 years, but your dad owned the boat for over 30.
Yeah, since 1977,
I mean, that must have been an emotional experience to, I mean, this boat has been in the family. I'm a sailor myself. I mean, I'd probably sell my children just as easily as I'd sell my sailboat.
Well, it's been very difficult for me because it was the love of my father's life. It was named after my grandmother, Julia, to lose her. And then, you know, the boat to me was almost, you know, like still holding on to a little bit of both of them. And so a wonderful man who is a very good boat mechanic, who I've known for years, has taken it over, and I could not be happier about that, knowing whose hands it's in and that all of the problems that it was beginning to develop are going to be taken care of now.
I am genuinely pleased about that. At least there is some good news to this story.
I have to ask your forgiveness. My voice is a bit hoarse. I've been traveling for a week now, incarcerated for days, and they've separated me from my money and my transportation and, you know, the ability to get to all the places I need to be to retrieve my property. Of course, they make these things so difficult for you to prepare for any defense.
Well, let's go ahead and start with your story, Star. What happened after you sold the boat?
Headed out to Salinas, which is a very tiny beach town, and lived in for, you know, off and on over 30 years where my children grew up. And my daughter and granddad, I have a 27-year-old daughter. It was her birthday. She just turned 27 on Friday when I was in jail. And I had intended to see my granddaughter also in Bolinas, who's three, and sing at one of my favorite saloons that I've been performing at since I was about 19 years old. And Bolinas really hasn't changed since I was 19. I sang a couple of songs there. I never saw the sun shine so bright. Never saw things going so right. Notice the day hurrying by. When you're in love, oh my, how they fly, those blue days. All of them gone, nothing but blue skies. From now on. An acquaintance offered me a place to park my van for the night, where I was sleeping, and on private property. So I was, he was riding with me to his home for the night, and we only got to about two blocks. The town is only about two blocks long, and I was, you know, they turned red lights on me, and I pulled over. I'm sure that I was driving perfectly. I don't drink. You know, I signaled and did all the correct things. But so I have no idea still to this day why I was pulled over. All I knew was I had a very bright light in my eyes, shining in my eyes. And so I asked the man to please not shine his light in my eyes, that it was very painful, and I asked him if he could identify himself, and he rattled off a name really quickly. I carry with me some papers which I call a conditional acceptance of oath, where I will, you know, in for such a situation, allow an officer for me to accept the oath for value. Upon their affirmation.
Oh, I'm sorry, here's the first page. Conditional acceptance of your oath.
To the people, to serve the people and protect us, and that they, and verification that they indeed did take such an oath and are acting upon it.
Can we sign it under duress? Can we sign it for you?
I don't think so. All this is saying is basically we're going to uphold the law.
The last request I'm making, because after that you will be handcuffed and you're going to be arrested.
Okay, well, officer, then you are also put on notice that you have dishonored your oath.
That's
to
fine.
The people.
So you want to know that they're defending, you know, the Constitution as they have sworn to do.
Exactly, and that they're not some sort of rogue agents to the U.S. Corporation.
You cannot ask the government for permission to do anything as long as we're harming no one. We have the right to do whatever we want. In fact, the government just asked
our permission. And little food right now. And in great pain because they have terrorized me and brutalized me. He was very erratic. He just rattled off his name, and I asked him again, could he identify himself as I reached for the papers, which were in fairly plain sight, and my pen to write down his information. Then I would hand him the paper and ask him to read it over and sign it. You know, so that I could be assured that he indeed was a peace officer protecting my safety. And he refused to present any type of card or identification to me after that, and just demanded that I step outside of the van.